All right. So I've seen a lot of people on their phones, and I'm pretty active. That's not a bad thing, but pretty active on LinkedIn, I'm assuming, and Twitter and other things. So it's no surprise that there's tons of amazing breakthroughs being highlighted on those forums around AI. It's sexy and exciting. I liken it to sprinkles, which we'll save for another time, but my kids want them everywhere. Everyone wants AI, right? So when we talk about the enterprise level, the truth is it's actually a lot of work, and it's really hard to get started and then keep that momentum going. So I'd love to learn and glean a lot of wisdom from our two panelists today, and I think we're going to open up with a little stage setting. So, Sheila, would you like to do that?
Yes, happy to do that. So, at Liberty Mutual, we're a 100-plus-year-old company, and with that comes a lot of challenges and opportunities. But one of the benefits of that from an AI perspective is we have a lot of data. So, our challenge is to really understand and leverage that data, understand how to harness the power of that data. So, behind all of the AI machinery, et cetera, is our data. And that is truly a competitive advantage, is really understanding how to leverage all the data that you have. In our company, as many legacy companies, we have a lot of data, but it's not in the same place. It's not in a centralized data lake just yet. So some of the challenge is really understanding how to basically sanitize that data and then how to make it available and to make it accessible for your AI solution. So I'll share just a little bit of our journey. I'll give you an example of one of the types of solutions that we have implemented for AI and machine learning. Our transformation story, just to give you a little bit of a view of Liberty Mutual, we have about 6,000 members in our technology organization. We work with our data scientist community that spread across our company. We have two external facing business units and one internal corporate functions team, which is the team that I lead. So we partner with our business. So what is it like today? This was actually one of the questions that our business presented to us. They basically were working on analyzing about 12 terabytes of telematics data. So really wanting to understand, we are gathering all of this telematics data, but how do we actually leverage it to help make better business decisions going forward for our customers? So that was basically one of the challenges. And they also were working and testing out Python. They were experimenting with methods. So that was our challenge. And one of the things that we did is basically we took all of this data. We had about 900 terabytes of hard to access data. Very tough. It was in an on-prem environment. We did move that to a cloud-based model. We built an internal, I was listening to our prior speaker also, so we did very much the same thing. Cortex, as you'll see it branded there, is our data platform product. So we do have a data platform team, and we built this product that basically enables our data science community. If you think of an on-ramp to leveraging your data scientist tool sets, like a DevOps environment for your data scientist, this is it. So we've basically built that on-ramp to enable our data scientists to pull down their own data, to build their own environments in the cloud with a touch of a button. They basically have the ability to go on through automated prompted questions that really don't require all of the technology understanding behind the scenes. So that was a huge enabler for us as well. We continue to build out that product, and it's been a huge enabler for us. And this was built using, of course, Amazon Web Services and a lot of the cloud-based tools provided through Amazon. And of course, you can see results. There's huge potential upside with this. We've actually built other similar models in the legal space, as well as in our pricing and actuarial area. So there's just tremendous opportunity to drive benefit to the business. And then, of course, being in financial services, we also have a tremendous amount of compliance and regulatory issues that we have to consider, all while building all of these wonderful new capabilities.
Okay, sounds easy, right?
And that took 3 months, by the way, three months in the top corner to actually get the solution out the door.
Out the door.
Yes, that was in the hands of our data scientist community where they were actually using it and they were able to access the information. I can't imagine how long that would have taken us previous to having the tools in place.
Wow. So I want to hear a little bit about Johnson & Johnson's journey.
Yeah, absolutely. So first of all, this is really impressive. I could have sat here and listened to you talk about this for most of the time we have here. So I've been with J&J for a little under three years, and I lead a group which is only about 30 people that I've hired that didn't exist before I got there, that's really responsible for figuring out what is J&J going to look like in 5 to 10 plus years. We have a more traditional IT organization that reports into our CIO, who reports into our COO. I actually report to our chief science officer, and the IT team at J&J is responsible for building the infrastructure and doing a lot of the sorts of things that you were just describing. I would say we're not as advanced as Liberty Mutual. Part of that is that like you, we are a 100-plus-year-old organization. We operate in 200-plus countries. We're incredibly decentralized. That has been changing a little bit over the last 5 or so years under Alex, our CEO. But part of it is also that the culture, and I'm not from the healthcare world. I'm from Google and Dropbox and startups, et cetera. So I'm still sort of learning this, but the culture that I have found in healthcare is not very data-driven. And particularly at a place like J&J, we've been very successful from a sales and marketing and clinical science standpoint. And so driving a cultural change around the importance of data and why we even need systems like this has been a big part of the last almost 3 years for me. And I think we're just starting to turn the corner on that and starting to get people smart and excited about what we can then start to do with all of that data. So how do we solve some of the world's most significant unmet healthcare problems in fundamentally different ways than we do today with our suite of products, many of which people are familiar with, our consumer brands, maybe less so with our medical device and pharmaceutical brands, which are actually the bigger parts of the J&J portfolio. But I think the journey for us has been slower, and I would say we're not as far along, I've heard often internally, we have to go slow to go fast. And I don't know if that's just a J&J thing or a bigger company thing generally, but I've certainly seen that.
So do you feel like in both your situations, it is, you've planned and articulated this amazing path and now you're going out and executing it, and that's that 3 month time frame, or was it and is it sort of building, planning, figuring out, oh, we forgot this, let's add this in, or oh, we also need to now, we've disrupted this other piece, building the plane as you're flying type of situation. So which of those scenarios do you?
Well, I would say, so I don't want to make it appear that we have 100% of everything figured out, we don't. I think that absolutely there's some of the building the plane while we're flying it still. I think in some of our areas where we have actually started very strategically, we focused on very tangible business results that we were looking for that we knew needed to be solved. We actually got our support of our business executives, so they were very excited about the work that we were doing in 100% partnership with our business and technology teams. And we actually did all of this. I'm actually also relatively new to Liberty. I was brought in to do a digital transformation of all of our corporate functions. So we're doing global transformations now for all of our global finance, as well as our global HR solutions, which as you can imagine, those are big, massive cloud-based solutions. You can imagine the set. But we also embarked on this with our very targeted solutions in legal and in some of our other areas, for example. And I would say start small with solution sets that you know you can solve for, where you have a team that's going to support you and be with you on the journey, iterate through it, test and learn, because that's a big part of what AI is really all about. So test and learn, and you have to be able to, as I say, fail forward a little bit, learn from it and have the momentum behind what you're doing to continue it.
There's a word I like to use for that. It's called flirting.
I love that.
You're
I'll use that.
You're failing and you're learning.
Thank you.
So you were flirting. That's great.
Yes.
So Mark, at J&J, did you, you know, in your journey, and I know you feel like you're a little behind the power curve here with Liberty, but is it more of forward-facing AI that you're targeting, or are you doing more of the back office? Like, how are you, where are your training wheels?
Yeah, it's a good question. So first of all, I would say that I could probably easily fill this stage with the number of thoughtful plans that we had developed for how we were actually going to become more of an AI-driven company. And I would say the reality is that most of those have gone virtually nowhere. And I think once you get into the businesses and deal with the incumbent leaders and their teams who have been running a certain playbook for a certain amount of time and had a tremendous amount of success, what I have learned is it becomes really messy and really challenging and uncomfortable for folks to start to think about how to solve problems mm-hmm. differently. And we've had to scrap yeah. those plans, and it's become much more seat of the pants and ad hoc. And I tend to be kind of a sports nut, and so there's all kinds of metaphors that we use internally, like hanging around the hoop and taking shots mm-hmm. on goal. We use that to talk about sort of our operating methodologies Perfect. Internally. Mm-hmm. So to go back to the question you're asking, we started off thinking, like, let's try to reinvent J&J. And I think that was just a little too much too fast for folks. And so then we tried to bring the horizon in and make it a little more manageable. Like, let's take the business that you have today and show how we can actually inflect the growth curve, which in a lot of our businesses outside of pharmaceuticals, our business, just because of the macro environments in which they operate, are relatively flat or very slow growing. They grow with inflation. And so we said, you know, we can 2x, 5x, 10x those businesses. A lot of that has to do with automating and using predictive analytics. Mm-hmm. And so we've been able to make some traction there, but I think it's been critical, and we have used that beachhead to continue to plug away at trying to get folks to think bigger than that. Because if we get too comfortable in thinking about how we're just going to optimize the existing business, we will be disrupted. You mentioned regulation. I think that tends to be sort of a defense that a lot of healthcare companies will often use as, and I hear it in financial
and
services.
Financial services.
Yep, exactly. Like, we're heavily regulated, and there's no way that many of these early stage startups are going to disrupt us. And to some extent, that's probably true, but when Apple and Google and Microsoft and other virtually endlessly deep-pocketed competitors come into a space like healthcare, as they increasingly are, and I welcome those oncomers, then I think that defense falls away, and we have to up our game. So I think we've got to do both. I don't know exactly how to do that perfectly because we haven't figured that out, but we are taking multiple shots on goal.
There's that sports analogy. And so when we've talked, I think that was interesting about the talent acquisition or the talent mm-hmm. Piece of the puzzle, mm-hmm. right? So whether it's acquisition or training, you talked about champions.
Yes.
So can you explain how you took that?
We actually take a multi-pronged approach, and I think you have to be very creative when you're a 100-plus-year-old company, and we're in Boston, and you would think, man, what a hunting ground for talent. I know you all think that there's MIT, there's Harvard, there's Boston College, Boston University, and on and on. The challenge is, and some of you probably work for some of these companies, when you walk outside the doors of MIT, right splashed in front of MIT are all of the offices of the Googles, all of the great companies, right, that are cool and much cooler than the 100-year-old companies. So that's a little bit of what we contend with. So we actually have a number of programs, both internally and for recruitment, that we have initiated for training. For example, we have Tech Start programs. We have ExecuTech programs where we actually educate also our internal executives. We have programs around mobility to encourage movement across our teams. One of the advantages of being in a large company with multiple divisions like Liberty Mutual is if there is an individual on my team, for example, that really wants to learn a new technology and I possibly don't have an opening at the time, we will move them to another business line so that they can stay with the company and leverage or grow that skill set. So we have a number of initiatives such as that around the company. Talent acquisition is tough, right? And I've learned we constantly are looking, I'll talk compensation, for example. We're constantly reassessing the compensation programs. What I've found is that it's really not necessarily all about the compensation that gets them in the door. You have to meet a certain point for that, but it's really about the stickiness of the interesting work that gives people challenging opportunities and new skills, and that's really what people are interested in doing. So we have to find ways to provide that every day, really.
Yeah, I would echo everything you said. I think for me, where I've really spent a disproportionate amount of my time at J&J is on the talent front, both in the acquisition of new talent and the retraining of existing talent. And I think the thing that has been startling for our existing HR team is that even after we can solve for the compensation stuff, there's a whole host of other issues that have to be addressed in order to become an employer of choice for the sort of talent that we're trying to attract. And it goes all the way down to, as I would imagine most of the folks in this room know as well, where you put your offices, what those offices look like, what sorts of amenities you put in there, framing up the career path at a place like J&J. We have a wall in New Brunswick where the company is based that recognizes employees who have been there for a certain number of decades. And the 50 plus employee is like hundreds of current employees. I've never worked in a place that's 50 years old, let alone that there are people who have been at the company for 50 years. Most of the talent that I am trying to hire with these sorts of skill sets thinks about the world in 2 to 3 year increments, for better or worse. They say, I'm gonna come in, I'm gonna have an impact or not in 2 or 3 years, and then I'm gonna reevaluate. And I may re-up, or I may go someplace else. That's a radically different way of approaching talent than a traditional company like a J&J or a Liberty Mutual. And so that has been a very challenging part that goes up to Alex, our CEO, and I've spent a lot of time sort of explaining just from my own personal experience when I was being recruited and playing back for him and the rest of the executive team, here's what you said to me, here's how I processed that and what my reaction was, which was often, it's cool, but that's just not the way someone like me looks at the world. And you were able to get there with me, and you may have rationalized it as, well, you're sort of a one-off type opportunity for a company like us, but we've got to think of this as more of we need to programatize the way that we go out and attract talent.
I love hearing that because I think you're hitting on the culture change, right? I mean, it's big when you're in companies that traditionally have focused on long tenure, and then you're bringing in a different approach. So that change can be a little tough at times.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. It almost sounds like digital transformation.
It is of the workforce.
Of the workforce, of the work kind. So there's always a people problem associated with the technology and the process. I've heard a lot about the champions, the retraining, the sort of rethinking your value proposition to the workforce, current and future. One thing we heard earlier today, probably a couple times, at least the two morning sessions I was in, was about the fact that instead of just competing for tech talent or AI talent, really looking at domain talent and industry talent and retraining them, because it's easier, and this is the premise, that it's easier to train them on technology as technology is becoming more democratized than it is to train somebody into industry and to get the domain expertise. So that's another thought.
It is, and we actually are doing a lot of that, and I think the balance and trade-off is, and you probably face a little bit of this, many of the talent that we have are allocated to lines of business, for example. So when is that time that you can actually pull investment aside to actually get that advanced training when you see the wave coming? And I think data engineering, data science, of course, would be one of those categories to invest in it. So knowing when is the right time to pull people off of maybe something that they're already skilled in to invest in them, and then to be able to put them right to work leveraging those new skills, I think is one of the key things for success.
Yeah, I think so. Before coming to J&J, I used to use phrases like, well, it's not brain surgery, but in fact at J&J some of the stuff we do is brain surgery, so I've had to use different analogies.
It is.
but what I'll often say is that while we'll often say things like bringing a drug to market or selling knees and hips or whatever is really complicated and it's unique, at the end of the day, if you take a really smart person that has a tremendous amount of intellectual curiosity and entrepreneurship, he or she is going to figure it out. And if you marry that person with the subject matter expert, at which I would imagine is the case also at Liberty Mutual, we have a ton of those at J&J, that's when the magic starts to happen. So that in some ways ties back as well to the whole talent thing, where we've had to try to move away from, well, we're going to try to solve this problem in oncology, so we need to hire an oncology expert. No, you don't really need to hire a predictive analytics expert who can partner with an oncology medical science expert to solve the problem in a unique way. That has been a real brain twist for a lot of folks. And a lot of what we have been doing is bringing in computer scientists that look nothing like traditional J&J people and just having them talk about problems that they're solving, whether they're healthcare problems or not, just so that folks can get exposed to a dramatically different way of looking at the world.
And I'll just share another unique way that we're partnering. You talked about partnerships, so I'll bring that up a little bit now. One of the things that we're also doing is we are partnering with some of the higher education institutions. We just partnered with MIT, for example, specifically in the area of AI, where we're providing them 50 different challenges. We've actually narrowed it down to about 50 business opportunities at Liberty, and we're providing those to MIT, and they'll be helping us to solution very unencumbered, out of the box, their way of thinking, their way first. So we'll have that creative thinking unencumbered by the walls that we have. So that's just another way I think that you can think about how to be creative with solving some of your problems or your opportunities, and you can also learn from that experience as well. Both ways.
And I love that you brought up the business units, right? So this morning, Matt's keynote, when he opened up, he showed a statistic that it was like 20-some percent that were polled said it was the business units who were driving AI. And then it moved up to 42% this year. I think it's interesting if we can move it to 60 or more, because as you had said, it's hard to get them to invest. Mm-hmm. But if they start to own this, which we're seeing that trend, then it will be a part of their business portfolio.
Right, and I agree. I think so much of that too is ensuring that you have senior executives and leadership teams that are educated enough in technology to be literate and not be afraid of that and understand what those parameters are. And we've really focused on one of the programs that we created is actually called ExecuTech, and it's a program that was created for that very purpose, so that we could educate our senior leaders on down in the organization enough on technology that they understand when we're having those conversations with them what the key drivers are, what it means, why we're asking for certain things, and why it takes a certain amount of time. And it's been, I think, a real positive for us.
Yeah, I would say, actually, one of the learnings that I've had at J&J is that a little knowledge can actually be a very dangerous thing. So as some of our leaders have gotten sort of an inch deep on things like AI, all of a sudden there's like 100 different AI projects that are being
sprinkles.
Yeah. And the question that I and my team will go back to the teams and ask is, what is the unmet end user need that we're really trying to solve here? That's where you as the business leader bring the greatest value. I'm not a healthcare person. I can't articulate what the unmet need is. But if you can articulate that, then we can come up with a solution instead of let's start with a solution and then just build something cool. And I think that's been a real challenge to try to get past that, why are we doing this? Because we can stage.
Mm-hmm. Problem curation, yes. Getting that problem statement. And I don't know where we are in time.
Close.
We're close? Would you guys mind if we took a question from the audience?
Oh, no, that's fine.
Not at all.
Okay. Will you tell me how many we can take? Because
we can take two.
Okay.
Hi. So we're a young company. We have the exact same programs you guys have with challenges, mm-hmm. with universities and explaining to our financial partners about HR practices that need to be done. What was kind of the, where has been the happy medium? Because we explained this to our partners. We have a partner that's a 100-year-old company, and they bought a little satellite in LA. And we're trying to explain to them that they need to change a lot of things to monetize their data properly. How do you explain the happy medium? Because we're having some challenges with some of our older partners that are 50, 60-year-old, 100-year-old companies.
Well, I'll tell you that one of the things that we've done at J&J that has been helpful is, I suppose it's sort of an example of just proving the concept. So we'll say, let's just hire one person who will demonstrate to you what is actually possible when you set that person loose on this sort of problem. Because all the abstract academic discussion about what someone who looks and has a very different background than what they're expecting is, at least what I've experienced, does not really get people there. But then saying, let's just go and hire this person, not a contractor. We've got to make this person an FTE. And then let's give him or her a hard problem to solve, and let's see what they do. And I think my experience has been that in every single instance that we've done that, and we've done that about half a dozen times, the business has been blown away by what is possible. They simply they just don't know what they don't know. And so how do you explain to someone that when they say, I don't see it, well, but it's there, I don't see it. Well, we'll actually make it there then, and then you can look at it, and then you'll appreciate, that's what you're talking about.
And I would definitely agree. I think it's really looking for an early win that's tangible, put the right team together, and because sometimes you get into that swirling on questions, just swirling. So when you get to that point, move past that to the point of, here's the recommendation, here's the approach that I would like to take, here's what we're going to bring forward, and just put it in place, and then they will see the results. And then once it clicks with a demo or a proof of concept, you know, using agile practices, we use them in our organizations, that we put a team together, we actually get those business partners on the team with our technology, whoever we need on the team, a SWAT team. It really doesn't matter what our organization and boundaries don't really matter at that point. It's more focused on the challenge that you're trying to solve for.
It is really about bringing in an outside team.
Yeah, well,
it really shows the new thing works.
The team that you need, yes. Whatever you need to put together to show that concept and will prove out.
One more question?
So when we've been talking about these things, the challenges you mentioned is, so if I want to do AI or machine learning, first I have to do some talent, either it's in-house, somewhere else, get talent. I have to do a chunk of data engineering to be able to then do something, yet do it quickly to demonstrate the value of it. And the challenge for, at least for big companies, at least the one I'm in, is by the time I can put all those pieces together, that itself is 6 months. Just like talking to HR, setting up talent, you know, doing all of those things, hiring new people, and then parallelizing all the data engineering efforts, which are their own special mess. And so how would you think of, what parts do you think are potentially outsourceable? Or do you think it all has to be done in-house? Because I was curious on like the data platform, you know, you guys built it in-house, whereas there exists tons of outsourced solutions that help make that faster. So how do you decide, like, okay, I'm going to do this in-house or I'll do it outside?
Sure. Well, I'll share ours, and it's really more based upon philosophy. I think depending upon where you are in your life cycle as a company and what your personal goals are. So, for example, we want to develop a competency and grow talent in these core skills. It's very important for us. So in the beginning, we chose to actually invest and have some teams, and I think it's important to have even if you have one, two, or three people that are really the champions in your organization, where you see them in the halls, and people know that's your AI guy because he is the one that is championing the mission. He's talking to everybody he can on his own. Like my guy, I can tell you, he's out there talking with the chief actuary. He has no qualms about talking to our CFO, to the chief legal counsel, whoever he needs to talk to really get that idea across. Can you outsource portions of it? Absolutely, but I think it's all in the approach that you choose to take. I'd like to address some of your questions, though. I know what you're talking about, being bogged down by the processes in a company, and I think you even at times need to be able to challenge that. So one of the things that we did, we actually implemented this past April, a solution that we had implemented in-house. It's called WorkGrid. We actually spun that team off. They're treated like a startup. They're inside of my organization, but they run like a startup. They hire quickly. They go through these processes very quickly. They're like a pilot team for us to actually learn how to do some things differently in the organization. So we've kind of used that as a test and learn for us to really look at how can we be faster, because you have to be able to turn, for example, even offers. If you're hiring a data scientist or a data engineer, you have to be able to get them through, get them the right offer, and get them hired as quickly as you can, because they'll have three or four other offers. So.
Yeah, if I may briefly add, I agree with all of that. I think one of the things that we have done at J&J is we've tried to bootstrap the bridging from where we are to where we need to get to. You mentioned partnerships with external partnerships. So like we announced a partnership a few months ago with Apple where we're doing something around stroke prevention and AFib. And I can tell you internally, there was a lot of discussion internally about, well, we can do the same thing. And it was like, yeah, we can, but it's gonna take us 2.5 years. And eventually, we will be able to do the same thing. We may not necessarily need to work with an external partner. And then the discussion became, what is a partnership as opposed to just a vendor relationship? We actually want both parties to put something at risk, to have skin in the game, and to share in the upside and the potential and the learnings. And that in and of itself was a fair amount of discussion. But I think just based on my own personal background, I've spent a lot of time doing partnerships and been lucky to be part of sort of a number of first of their kind stuff that was not totally foreign to me. And so that's been another part of a new playbook that we've been rolling out as the partnership angle, even as we try to build up our own first party competencies.
Great. Well, I think we're at time. Thank you very much. I hope you all walked away with some insights. I know I sure did. Thank you.
Thank you.